eagerly waiting for this session, Hocus Pocus, the science behind hallucination. The title seems too interesting, huh? To explain this, we have an amazing mentor for our session, Dr. Yamini. Having done her MBBS, MD Psychiatry, senior residentship from BMCRI, she is also an assistant professorship at NIMHANS. She has done a fellowship in psychosexual medicine in JSS University, Mysore. Currently, she is pursuing her private practice in Casper Multispeciality Clinic, Bangalore. Welcome to you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that, Shweta. So the first half of my session would be on basic introduction about hallucinations. Right. Coming to perception. So we need to understand what is perception to ultimately understand how hallucinations are produced. So perception is the way we receive a stimulus which is present in the environment. And once that is taken in by the various sensory modalities that one possesses, irrelevant information that is related to that particular sensory stimuli is first eliminated. Then what happens is that particular sensory stimulus is then understood with the help of various amounts of data that we already possess about that particular stimulus. This helps in the formation of what is referred to as percept. So for example, say we are looking at a pen, right? So that is a visual way of perceiving a pen. As soon as I see it, of course, I'm going to look at several oddities in the pen. Perhaps the cap is broken or there are stains on the pen. And that somehow seems irrelevant for me at that point in time when it comes to recognizing what article I'm holding. So that would be probably eliminated. And that will help in making the concept of percept of a pen in my hand. And then what happens is we need to understand that this percept needs to have a personal meaning, or it definitely does have a personal meaning to each one of us. So when a personal meaning is attached or a personal experience is attached to this percept, we refer to this phenomena as a perception. So this again helps us in learning or attaching more meaning to a particular stimulus that is in our surroundings. So for example, this pen may actually remind me of a kind of ballpoint pen which I've used for an exam just the previous week, right? So this adds this additional importance to this particular stimulus. So this is exactly how any stimulus in the environment gathers more personal meaning or more personal significance to each one of us. So sensation leads to perception and then leads to a perception. Now, what we also need to understand is that perceptions are quite different when in comparison to mental images. Now, perceptions are substantial. It is produced, or a percept is produced as a result of a sensory stimulus in the environment. It appears in the objective space, that is in a space outside of our body or outside of our personal boundaries. It's clearly delineated, it's constant, it's independent of the will, whether we like it or not, it's there, and it's interpreted as a percept. And the sensory elements are full and fresh, which means to say that the boundaries are well delineated, the color is of a particular nature, the intensity is of a particular nature. So there are various characteristics that can be attached to the percept. Okay, so these are perceptions. On the other hand, mental images are incomplete. So mental images, or imagery, in other words, is something that's incomplete. It may not be clearly delineated. It is somehow dependent on will. If I will, I think of the image. If I don't want it, it does go away. It exists in the subjective space, which means to say it's more or less within our own ability, within our own personal boundaries. It can be inconsistent, it can come, go, inconstant, and it can be recreated with more modifications. So as we see, mental imagery in a way can be manipulated, okay, but not so when it comes to perception. What else do we have to know about perception in general, and also about hallucinations? So hallucinations was considered as independent diseases itself in the 16th and the 18th centuries. And it was not really attached to any syndrome or other disorders. Esquirol in about 1817 was the first to coin the term hallucination. Then, of course, there were other phenomenologies which were discovered and labeled, referred to as sensory madness by Lager in 1844, which predominantly involved hallucinations. Also, it was only during the 19th century that there was this understanding that hallucinations may be a sign and not exactly a disorder on its own. So hence it started becoming a feature of several other diseases and hence became a marker, right? Also, how do you approach hallucinations? There were varying ways in which people wanted to explain how hallucinations develop, the neurological basis, the psychodynamic basis, and so on. And till today, one aspect which is very closely related to hallucinations is pseudo-hallucinations. And there's quite a lot of debate on this topic. As the discussion progresses, we shall also look at what pseudo-hallucinations are. So basically, the slide tells us the various entities by which hallucinations were known as, and how it has undergone a variety of change based on research and based on evidence over history. Now, before we look at hallucinations as first, let's get a larger perspective. Let's understand that hallucination forms a part of disorders of perception. And disorders of perception on the whole can be divided into two broad wings. So one is disorders of sensory distortion, and the other one is disorders of sensory deception. So hallucination is a disorder of sensory deception. So sensory distortions would mean there is change in the intensity of what is being perceived, change in the quality of what is being seen, a change in the form, spatial form. An object or a percept may be perceived with respect to experience of time. That is, it may be perceived much slower than what its exact motion is. Or it could be perceived in a time frame which is much slower than what the exact time frame should look like. So these are all sensory distortions. And on the other hand, we have sensory deceptions, wherein we are looking at illusions, hallucinations, and pseudo-hallucinations. I wouldn't be going too much in detail about sensory distortions, but this is just to highlight how sensory distortions are meant to be. There could be disturbance in intensity like the previous slide just showed us. So when it comes to auditory disturbances in intensity, there can be hyperacusis or hypoacusis. There is an increased tendency to perceive sounds, or there could be a decreased tendency to perceive sounds. Visually as well, there could be heightened color perception. And this can be seen in various disorders as is being highlighted. Also, you could have disturbances in quality, which means to say, again, color changes. Xanthopsia would mean a predominantly yellow coloration of things that are being viewed. It has been noted with digoxin, which can cause cataractous changes, which leads to more of yellow color perception in individuals who tend to have cataract due to digoxin. Similarly, there could be changes in taste, and changes in form, like we discussed, macropsia, objects seeming larger than their actual size, micropsia, objects seeming much smaller than their actual size, or dysmegalopsia, wherein there is a complete distortion, a complete difference in perception when it comes to form of a percept itself. Sensory deceptions now, as we highlighted before, could be illusions, hallucinations, and pseudo-hallucinations. So when we look at illusions, we are basically looking at an object. You look at stimuli from a perceived object, And that is combined with a mental image to produce a completely false perception, which means to say there is a stimulus and you perceive the stimulus, but you don't perceive the stimulus just as it is. You tend to combine it with some other mental images that you already possess, and hence the outcome would be a false perception altogether. This is often seen when there are organic etiologies which the person may be suffering from, and it can also be as a result of a set, which means to say a mental set or a mental frame from which it's difficult for us to detach. So hence, everything and anything that's viewed will be viewed in that way only. So that again forms a very distinct form of illusion. So illusions. Now, there are different types of illusions. One is completion illusion, another called affect illusion, and then pareidolic illusions. So completion illusion, as the diagram rightfully suggests, it's a brain's tendency to fill in presumed missing parts of an object to produce a meaningful percept. So if you see the stimulus that is being shared with you, the first image, you can see quite clearly see that there are three circles and there is a triangle. But somehow the circles are not complete. And the triangle, the sides of the triangle as well are not complete. So if you were to look at this image for a particular amount of time, it's quite evident that you will presume that perhaps there is a white triangle which has been placed over these three dark or black objects. And hence that's why you have these missing parts. But that again is just filling in the gap. And that may not actually be what it is as has been presented. So that's called a completion illusion. Often this happens when we are reading text, could be reading newspapers, and then we just fill in the rest of the word just by reading one or two letters of the starting of the word itself. So that's a completion illusion. Coming to affect illusion is occurs in the background of heightened emotionality. So in case someone's very, very fearful and they were to see the second stimulus which is placed on our screen, it's quite obvious that they are going to guess that that's a snake rather than a rope. So again, that's affect illusion. And then pareidolic illusions, where you have these, you know, individuals who have fantastic thinking, which means to say that they can think out of the box and they can make meaning of percepts in a more fantastical way, in a more vivid visual manner, almost like what happens in our third diagram, which is just a cut section of capsicum, but it almost looks like it's a, you know, laughing face. So that's exactly what pareidolic illusions are. Coming to pseudo hallucinations, and this is an important aspect that we need to understand, because quite often there is overlap of pseudo hallucinations with hallucinations. Sometimes they are co-occurring phenomena. Sometimes a distinction needs to be made between the two. But somehow pseudo hallucinations have not been wholeheartedly supported in history. So there have been many, many researchers who have felt that pseudo hallucinations are in fact true hallucinations, just that their intensity is much lesser than true hallucinations. But however, let's look at the current standing of what pseudo hallucinations are. So what is understood is pseudo hallucinations are somewhere in between a true hallucination and mental imagery, like how we discussed. There are certain aspects of pseudo hallucinations which are different from that of hallucinations. So they do not have the sensory consistency that hallucinations have. So we did remember that mental imagery were also quite the same. So pseudo hallucinations somehow are slightly more well defined than mental imagery, but definitely less well defined than true hallucinations. So by consistency, we mean how objectively we can describe a pseudo hallucination, its details, its corporeality, which means how much it is related to the body of the person who's explaining about it, on the substantiality of the perception in terms of the characteristics of the pseudo hallucinations. All of this is much lesser or much less clarity is there in pseudo hallucinations versus that of hallucinations. These can be observed in full consciousness. They are located in the subjective space, which means to say an individual will be able to tell you that it is his own voices that he can hear from within. It is his own, the origin of these hallucinations or these perceptions are actually from within him. Okay, and that is what we mean as a subjective space. It can also be marginally modified by will, which means to say it can be initiated and interrupted by an individual's will. And it's also known that individuals may possess some degree of insight. This level of insight can vary from having full insight to having very poor insight. But the same cannot be said about hallucinations, because to a large extent, hallucinations, the insight is quite poor. Okay, and many a times it can coexist with hallucinations. So it can occur when a person is recovering from, mental illnesses, wherein pseudo hallucinations and hallucinations can co-occur. Now, just to give you an example of how pseudo hallucinations are perceived, you could have an individual who has alcohol addiction, and he is someone who is dependent on the substance. So he would probably report to you that if he has cue-induced craving or habitual craving, he would probably suggest to you that 6 p.m. every evening, he hears this, bottle opening sound, okay? And after which he hears cheers. And he very, blatantly reports to you that it is somewhat like his own voice. He knows that if he can, run away from the clock which shows the timing, he's somehow able to not hear those voices. And then he also tells you that there are times in which he can just stop those voices by probably plugging in, music, or also listening to his children play, and so on. So these are ways in which the man is suggesting to you that it is within his will or control to some extent. He's also able to suggest to you that this perhaps is his own voice, but a voice which is motivating, a voice that is provoking in ways that he may not be able to fully control. Also, he's suggesting to you that it is more or less dependent on the mood state that he is in. So he is in a state where he is desperate, he is distressed, and hence the voices that he hears is more or less comforting, provoking, stimulating, and so on, for him to go and procure what he otherwise wouldn't do. So pseudo hallucinations, like I suggested to you, through the course of history has had supporters, has had people who have vehemently opposed, or people who have had no particular stand. But what we need to understand is pseudo hallucinations most definitely in the current standing need to be evaluated and also distinguished from hallucinations. And why is that? Simply because pseudo hallucinations have no validity. So they do not have any diagnostic validity, which means to say that you do not attribute pseudo hallucinations to any particular form of illness. It is not pathognomonic to any form of illness. Hence, it's very, very important for us to understand what are pseudo hallucinations and when are hallucinations actually seen. So this again is a differentiation between true hallucinations and pseudo hallucinations, and it contains almost everything that we've already discussed. Right. So I'll just skip this slide because it's more or less what we've already discussed. Coming to hallucinations. So again, when Esquirol actually named or coined the term hallucinations, he said that it's a perception without an object, which means without a stimulus. it's a false perception, but sometimes it is perceived as the at the same time as the real perception, is what Jasper had to say. False perception is how it is defined in SCAN, which is an important way in which we define each illness. Also, they come from within, which means to say that it is emanating or it is originating from an individual's own mind. But the individual somehow funnily responds to it in a manner that it's actually coming from the outside world or the external environment. And also we need to know that hallucinations can most commonly happen in many physiological conditions as well. So it's not pathological in all ways. Sometimes it can happen with sleep deprivation, with sensory deprivation, also with grief and so on. What else do we have to know? We need to know that, it's involuntary in most ways. So it would come out of the blue or without one's control. And once it's there, a hallucination is being perceived, it's very difficult for an individual to control it or interrupt it or as a matter of fact, even initiate an hallucination. So it's quite independent of will. Right. At this point in time, I'll just skip over to the science behind hallucinations, and for that, I'll just need to refer to my other slide. Yes. So here we go. The science behind hallucinations. I just thought that you might also possibly need to know that there are a variety of scales which are available for evaluating or validating a person's experience which borders on hallucinations. Of course, many of these are quite easily available and you can actually refer to them on the internet. One such scale is the auditory hallucination rating scale. And this has just been highlighted to you so that you have an understanding of what are the different domains in which hallucinations can be actually spoken of. So one, you talk of frequency, how frequently an individual is disrupted by auditory hallucinations, or in other words, most commonly, the most formed variety of auditory hallucinations are voices. So how often do voices occur? Reality, how real do these voices seem to you? Loudness, on average, how predominant are these voices? Number of voices, if they can actually make out the number of interruptions that they have and the number of voices that they listen to. The length, how extensive is the content of that predominant voice? What all does the voice convey, and so on. Attentional salience, to what degree do these voices alter what an individual thinks, feels, or does? That is, how much of a preoccupation is there for this individual who is having this phenomenology? And of course, the distress levels, the level of anxiety and agitation that these voices can cause in an individual. So all of this can be, can be placed as domains when we sit down to question or evaluate an individual having hallucinations. Now, coming to theories, and I guess here is the interesting part of what really leads to the formation of hallucinations. So, of course, there have been several theories. We will discuss a few of these theories. Of course, it's not possible within the limited frame of time that we have to finish the entire discussion. But we will look at a few important theories and see how that has influenced our understanding of hallucinations. So one of the theories is conditioning theory by Heffernan in 1971. He proposed this in 1971. Of course, there's seepage theory by West. And seepage theory basically suggests that any pre-conscious material, which means to say the psychological understanding of the mind, is that there are three aspects to it, which is the conscious aspect of the mind, the unconscious aspect of the mind, and this gray zone, which is referred to as the pre-conscious aspect of the mind.
Excuse me, ma'am. Sorry to interrupt. Slide is not moving, ma'am.
Okay. Now, how about it, Shweta? Are you able to see?
No, ma'am. I'm not able to see.
Okay. Let me just stop share and then restart it. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
How about it now?
Yeah, ma'am. Perfect.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Right. So we are looking at theories, and just getting back to what I was discussing, you have conditioning theory, then the seepage theory. We will look at conditioning theory in a moment. Seepage theory suggests that there are certain pre-conscious materials, and in the face of sensory deprivation, that is someone who is placed in an environment which has no sensory bombardment at all, such an individual will have certain pre-conscious material which will leak into the conscious mind, and that's when they start perceiving things which are not there. So this was important theory that was suggested in 1962. Then of course there's imagery theory. Again, I will let you know what that means, and the sub-vocalization theory by Gould. Okay, so now coming to the conditioning theory. So if you see the diagram, there are two aspects for us to understand the percept or to make meaning of a stimulus. So what are these two aspects? One is a bottom-up processing, and another which is a top-down processing. So bottom-up processing are nothing but sensory pathways which help us understand what we are surrounded by. Okay, so basically these sensory pathways will take in sensory information of any stimulus that we are subjected to, and then they help in assembling and integrating that particular stimulus. And as we suggested, it helps in the formation of an initial percept. So that is bottom-up processing. So bottom-up processing is basically trying to have a goal of what am I seeing, okay? Then of course you have the top-down processing, wherein you have certain expectations in a particular context. You have a kind of an idea of what you're looking at. You have already formed models of what that particular percept should look like, right? And you try to interpret the incoming sensory information based on all of this. That is based on models and ideas and expectations. And basically, the top-down processing has a goal of, is this something that I've already seen? So for example, say we are looking at a geometrical figure like rhombus, right? So the sensory information that would be taken in, that it's okay, it's a four-sided figure, it's slanting, the lines all meet, and this is how, the maths question needs to be solved based on what I'm looking at. Soon enough, the top-down processing tells you that doesn't this resemble a rectangle? And then does this mean that it has the same properties as a rectangle? So basically, top-down processing helps in further modulating a percept that is initially formed by the bottom-up processing. Okay, so a very active interplay happens between the bottom-up and the top-down processing for us to come to an understanding as to what we are seeing. And this is extremely important, and this is referred to as the conditioning theory. Now, just a moment ago, I did tell you that there was one theory when people like the seepage theory, which was basically a psychological theory. But if you look at it in this context, it is basically trying to tell us that in case there is any deprivation of, say, a bottom-up processing in any way. So either it's compromised or you have a stimulus which is expected but not there, then the top-down processing will predominate, and you will see a thing which is not there, or you will hear something which is not there. You will feel something which is not there because it's expected to be there. Okay, so these theories basically suggest that it is a form of overcompensation that is done by our active brain to help in understanding a particular environment. Okay, subvocalization theory. Now, this was a theory that I've always found very interesting. Okay, so let's look at a daily example that we are all very familiar with. Let's think of the examination hall, and we are, a question paper is handed over to us, and we start going through all the questions, and then we realize that we know a few questions and a few questions we don't, right? And often when we are reading through the questions, pretty much in our mind, we sometimes have a neighbor just seated beside us or behind us saying, hey, this is the answer for this one. And then you're quite surprised that they actually, knew that you were doubtful about something and answered that. And then you ask how, and then they say, you're reading it out so loud, right? And then you question yourself that, was I really loud? I wasn't. So in a lot of such conditions, we when we are in a particular situation which requires a lot of mental dialogue or self-dialogue, often it goes unnoticed that people would not know that you have actually thought of something and you are talking to yourself in quite literal terms. But sometimes we can get loud, and that is very easily caught on by others. So if we are loud, then that would be vocalization. But if we are not, then that's actually called sub-vocalization, wherein an individual has self-talk. And by self-talk, we actually mean that it starts with a thought, and then there is a self-dialogue. And self-dialogue means there is very much a possibility of motor movement of our vocal cords, and also speech which is emanated, but in a very, very, very low volume, which cannot be caught on by others. So that's basically called sub-vocalization. So what the understanding of hallucinations to a large extent is that could these actually be sub-vocalizations? That means an individual has a particular thought. From that thought, there is a need to speak, which means to say there is a need for self-dialogue. And self-dialogue would mean a need for speaking out your own mind. Okay, and when that is done at a very, very, very low volume, which is not to be heard by others, it can actually be a phenomenon very close to that of hallucinations. But what is the important difference between self-dialogue and hallucinations? An individual, if they were questioned, they'll say, yeah, I was talking to myself. But a person, say, with schizophrenia would not say that. They would say that I heard someone speak and I think I know who it is. Or, it's someone who's sitting 50 meters away from me, right? So why is this discordant in an individual with, say, a psychotic illness or schizophrenia? Simply because these sub-vocalizations are not referred to or are not owned up by the individual because they do not feel that this is self. The sub-vocalization or the sounds that are emanating from themselves, they would feel that that is not self, it is non-self. And non-self, why? Something which is very, very interesting is these voices to these individuals with psychotic illness or with schizophrenia would actually seem different in tonality. They would actually feel very different in texture. They would feel very different in, the manner in which the words have been placed. So that is why they would not feel like owning up to their sub-vocalizations, and they would feel that this is actually being told by someone else and not self. Okay, and this process is referred to as projection process, wherein they say that these sort of grammatical errors can't be produced by me, or this sort of tone cannot be me, or this sort of pattern of vocalization cannot be me. So that is why it's someone else and it's not mine. Okay, and that is how they're able to differentiate and suggest to us that these are voices which they are unfamiliar with, or they do not know where it's coming from, but it's definitely not their own. So again, this was one way of explaining how auditory hallucinations happen. Coming to certain important disorders, for example, there could be disorders wherein perception at the most peripheral level is affected. That is the sensory input, right? These are the most common disorders wherein sensory input is compromised. So one is Charles Bonnet syndrome. The other is the phantom limb syndrome. And most of us are quite aware of at least both the names. So what exactly happens in Charles Bonnet syndrome? This is a syndrome wherein an individual who has lost vision, it was first described in an individual who has recently lost his vision. And this could be as a result of cataract, it could be as a result of any sort of trauma, wherein there is complete visual loss. After which, like we previously discussed as in conditioning theory, the individual may tend to start seeing objects when they are not there, or they can actually not see because they are sensibly, they are optically deprived, visually deprived, but yet they would be able to suggest to us that they can see these very bright, vivid images. Also images which are also referred to as passage hallucinations, that is hallucinations that can come and go through walls. Lilliputian hallucinations are quite common in Charles Bonnet syndrome, which means to say that objects seem much smaller than what their actual size is. So a book may seem like a very, very small, object. Similarly, some other large objects may seem much smaller proportionately to what a normal individual would cite them as. So Charles Bonnet syndrome refers to this disorderliness when it comes to sensory input and interpretation of the sensory input. And it particularly, refers to visual hallucinations that individuals have. Coming to phantom limb syndrome, I think a lot of us would have read a lot about it. I would love to speak on it at length, but today, since we have an objective of covering hallucinations, we'll just look at phantom limb syndrome, wherein an individual has recently lost a limb, either due to accident, trauma, or because of a surgical amputation. So they would feel that there is pretty much a presence of that limb even now, though that limb is not present. And various variations to this would be, individuals would feel that the entire length of the extremity is gone, but just the hands stand as stumps to their body, though the hand would have been removed and also the arm would have been removed, they would still feel that the hands are still there and not the entire arm. Again, a corollary to this would be phantom limb pain, where an individual have excruciating amount of pain, as if it were to be emanating from the tip of the fingers, wherein an individual has already gone, already had a complete amputation of the entire limb. Okay, so all of these are again disorders related to sensory input. Again, this comes under the umbrella of hallucinations and has to be dealt with in the same manner. Again, hallucinations can also occur because of midbrain disorders and not just disorders related to the sensory pathway. Why is that? Because this particular diagram helps us understand that. So we very well know that there's a relay of important sensory stimuli from the thalamus to the cortex. And cortex has primary sensory areas, and it also has association areas, or the higher order sensory areas. Now, what happens is the thalamus As it's relaying these sensory inputs to these higher regions or the higher cortical regions, we find that brainstem plays a very important role in modulating this relay. So what it does is, with the help of acetylcholine and with the help of serotonin, it actually helps in either driving or promoting sensory input, or it tends to reduce. So what has been understood is that it actually switches the thalamus from a state of waking to a state of sleeping. So a waking relay mode is converted into a sleeping mode, most commonly by the brainstem with the help of acetylcholine and serotonin. And that's because the cell bodies of neurons which help in the production of acetylcholine and serotonin are both based in the brainstem. So the brainstem areas, which have the reticular regions, help in modulating this sort of relay from the thalamus to the cortex. So what happens is, most commonly, there are something called pedicular hallucinations which happen as a result of midbrain pathologies. So pedicular hallucinations have been highlighted in the first picture, and these are basically so real, so vivid and so clear, that it may be perceived as very much real for an individual who has had any sort of midbrain pathology. Above is a case scenario where an individual who is a 74-year-old man has several features suggestive of such a pathology, and he has episodic evening hallucinations, which are often triggered by eye closing, and it lasts for a few minutes, and then he almost normalizes completely when there has been corticosteroids given. And this is a sketch which has been made by that particular patient itself. So these are basically, you would have very vivid imagery, very, very vivid hallucinations of landscapes, people, animals, sometimes even grotesque or deformed faces. Repeated patterns could keep appearing, and Lilliputian hallucinations, very similar to Charles Bonnet. You could have Lilliputian hallucinations here too. However, these are going to last for only a few minutes or hours. Okay, and often they will be accompanied by tactile or auditory hallucinations. Now, this is very different from that of Charles Bonnet. Like, as we discussed, Charles Bonnet is predominantly visual hallucinations. It's not seen with any other form of hallucinations. But here, in pedicular hallucinations, you can have multimodal hallucinations. And these hallucinations are short-lasting, a few minutes to few hours. So that forms a very simple way of distinguishing the two forms of hallucinations. Of course, we have commonly heard of what are known as hypnagogic and hypnopompic hallucinations. Hypnagogic would mean hallucinations which occur just prior to us falling asleep. And hypnopompic would be us witnessing hallucinations just as we are awakening from sleep. And I would say often, because a lot of us who have actually experienced these hallucinations, they are very vivid, very clear, and emotionally very charged. So what are the feelings or what are the hallucinations like? So you would get a feeling that you're about to fall into an abyss, or you're being attacked, or you're caught in a fire, or almost as if there is some sense, some presence in the room, as if there's a ghost or a spirit in the room. So these are commonly the experiences that are narrated by individuals with hypnagogic or hypnopompic hallucinations. I also wanted to highlight to you that, other than the theories that we just discussed and some very unique forms of hallucinations, there are certain important findings that have come across in individuals with constant hallucinations. And if you were to be aware of this, then it would just give you an edge in evaluating a patient better. One is the right ear advantage. So right ear advantage is a physiological phenomenon where it is understood that all of us tend to have a predominance or a right ear advantage over a left ear advantage. In very simple words, it means that if the right ear and the left ear were to be presented by syllables or consonants or vowels, which are usually dichotic, like say papa or baba, like in the diagram, it is seen that it is the right ear stimuli which is better perceived, better processed, and better worked on than the stimulus which is presented to the left ear. And this physiologically happens in all individuals, and it's very closely related to the handedness of an individual. So which means to say that the right ear advantage depends on handedness and is more obvious in individuals with right-handed, individuals who are right-handed. It also means to say that there is left hemisphere dominance in these individuals, and left hemisphere dominance is left hemisphere is important in syllable processing. So that's exactly why, if there is right-handedness and left hemisphere dominance, you have these individuals being obviously displaying a right ear advantage, and they tend to have very good syllable processing. This means to say that contralateral transmission of information happens to the left hemisphere. That is, from the right ear, the left hemisphere is able to perceive the sensations. And also, ipsilateral sensations, that is, the sensations which come from the left ear, are suppressed. So both of these things have to happen hand in hand for us to have a right ear advantage. And this is the asymmetry which is physiologically seen in individuals. What has been found in people with schizophrenia? It's seen that people with auditory hallucinations and schizophrenia, this kind of right ear superiority has been lost. And they also tend to have this left temporal dysfunction. So that was an interesting finding. How does that relate to an individual having auditory hallucinations is still not understood clearly, but this is almost like a constant finding in individuals with schizophrenia. So the next slide again goes on to suggest the same, that in schizophrenia, if you're a non-hallucinator, then the normal pattern still persists. That's the right ear advantage still persists. But in schizophrenia with hallucinators, this sort of asymmetry is not seen. Left temporal lobe advantage is lost, and dysfunctionality in the left temporal lobe is much more in these individuals. And higher dysfunctionality, greater the risk for auditory hallucinations is what has been seen. This was an important phenomenology or finding that I thought we should also discuss, considering that we have discussed theories and we have looked at different types of hallucinations. Of course, there are a host of other hallucinations that I would like to discuss if time permits. But beyond that, now coming to findings. So the one finding that we should understand is the loss of asymmetry. That is the hearing advantage or the right ear advantage. The second aspect, that phenomena that we need to understand, is discourse planning. So first we'll look at what is discourse planning, and then we'll see what exactly happens in individuals with hallucinations. So let's look at this example. An interviewer is asking an individual, can you describe where you live? And this particular patient says, yes, I live in Connecticut. We live in a 50-year-old Tudor house. It's a house that's very much a home. I live there with my husband and son. It's a home where people are drawn to feel comfortable, walk in. Let's see, a home that's furnished comfortably, not expensive, a home that shows very much my personality. Now, when you hear this verbatim by a patient, you have already started processing their verbal output. And when you've processed the verbal output, we can actually make a tree geometry of what we have just heard. Okay. And this happens quite automatically in us. And discourse planning, either by the person who's talking and also for a person who's interpreting someone's discourse or word pattern is very important for understanding conversations and also for giving responsible and relevant answers. Okay, so and it's important that discourse planning phenomena happens during with the help of working memory. For example, if we were to look at any conversation, like the conversation that's just happened, you see that the person said, "I live in a house." Thereafter, she goes on to say, "I live in a house which is in Connecticut. A house is a home. The house shows my personality." And from there on, it can, it can branch out into people like my personality. So people, so I assume that they will like the home as well. Home is comfortable. It's comfortably furnished. Furniture is not expensive, but it's still good. And the house is a 50-year-old Tudor house. House is a home. I live in a house with my husband and son. So somewhere we see that each of her thought trails are quite well linked. And when we are able to construct this tree geometry, we are able to understand that one link leads to the other, and the other. So this is referred to as ordering. So one, we can construct a tree geometry, and then there is ordering. That is, one segment leads into another segment. So S1 leads into S2. S2 may lead into S1, but yet there, that link is persisting. And if there's an S3 segment, then S1 and S2 together lead on to S3. So this is basically how conversations or verbatim can be understood or displayed. Now, what happens in individuals is that there could be discourse planning errors, okay, which was identified by Hoffman in 1986. And he said that predominantly these are formal thought disorders. So what we looked at was a thought disorder. An individual with good discourse planning will be able to give us very coherent answers. And a person with planning errors will give us planning errors because of thought disorder will give us very confusing answers. Okay, but this is all in the plane of thought. What is understood is individuals who have these thought errors or thought disorders can go on to display hallucinations, which are auditory in nature. So that's quite interesting to understand that a person with a thought disorder can actually have auditory hallucinations. And this was a link that was found in a whole lot of individuals. And it was seen that, yes, they will have poor thought processing and coherence when they give out answers. But in addition to that, it's also found that they might have auditory hallucinations as well. And if they have more of negative symptoms, that is someone who is more withdrawn, less motivational levels, less ability to feel pleasure, individual who has, as I told you, less motivation, they will tend to have less auditory hallucinations. So it's only with those who display more and more, verbatim, which has thought disorder, that auditory hallucinations would be seen. Now, this is just another example to tell you that how this can be, the same sort of discourse planning errors can be seen in individuals. I'll not go into the detail, but the example suggests that an individual who has just attempted on life is asked, "Did you ever hurt yourself?" And the patient, we in this case, is, we are expecting that they will speak about their feelings about suicide after being admitted to a psychiatric hospital. The patient goes on to say, "I cut myself once when I was in the kitchen trying to please David. I was scared for life because David didn't want me. And if David didn't want me, then no man would." So when we listen to this verbatim, definitely there seems to be a loss of coherence. And this is, referred to as connectivity. And that somewhere is lost. And that's exactly what the tree geometry tells us, that on one hand, the person seems to be quite scared for life and feels that it should not have been attempted. On the other hand, she also poses as if it was an accidental attempt. And she was, it happened when she was trying to please David, which really does not make any sense. So these are the kind of individuals who may tend to have higher amount of hallucinations. I mean, this was something else that I thought would be very interesting, and I hope I'm well within time. I hope to, you know, at least clear this one particular aspect before we call it a day. So hallucinations, when you have visual hallucinations, a lot of times what has been remarkably found is that a visual hallucination actually stems from a verbal image. Okay, so the image in front of you is an apple. So when I say apple, you are hearing it. A few of you who are listening to this is also for feeling an apple, which means to say feeling the skin of the apple. A few of you are looking at the image and seeing it. So you see an apple. All of this comes under verbal images. So a verbal image is an image wherein an individual can see, hear, or feel that particular image. So visual hallucinations are nothing but verbal images, okay, with the feeling of unintendedness, which means to say, I didn't create it. It just came to me, or it was put on me, or it was placed on me. Okay, so this level of disconnect is felt for a verbal image. And if so, then it leads to visual hallucinations. So this was one other understanding or finding that was seen in a whole lot of individuals. And this particular table tells us how intendedness is very, very important when it comes to verbal images. So if the verbal image is strongly intended, that means it's mine and no one else has imposed it on me. That is the otherness inference, or others having imposed it on me is absent. So if I have a strong intendedness for an image, for example, I am talking about Adam and Eve, and when I'm saying this, a few of you may instantly think of a verbal image of an apple. Either they see it, or they are hearing it within themselves, or they're feeling it, right? And it may come spontaneously and with a feeling of strongly being intended. That is, you felt that you should think of the apple and you thought of it. Okay, so that has no imposition by me on you. It's just a matter of fact that you remembered the apple. Okay, but imagine me telling you the story of the sour grapes, where the fox tries to lunge at a bunch of grapes and can't reach it, and so it says sour grapes and goes. Or I'm just telling you that story and you think of an apple. Okay, and some people, when they thought of the apple, would still feel that, yeah, I intended to think of it, so it's still mine. Few others would feel that I shouldn't have thought of it, but I did, so I don't know what that even means. Okay, even here, the otherness factor is not there. They don't think that someone else has imposed it on them. However, if the individual is strongly opposed to this verbal image of apple in that story and feels that I should have never thought of it, but it came to my mind, it's not my thought. It's definitely not mine. Now, this transpires into visual hallucinations in an individual. That is, an individual with this sort of understanding, wherein verbal images are completely unintended, strongly unintended, and has been brought on by an external agency, such individuals may tend to have more of visual hallucinations. So this is exactly what this particular slide refers to. And of course, quickly I'll brush through a few other findings. So what is also understood is that all of our brains, from the time that we are born to the time that we reach our adolescence, is constantly under change. And that is referred to as pruning, cortical pruning. Pruning is pretty much like a gardener trimming off the edges of a plant. So here, what we mean by pruning is the connectivity between neurons, basically by all the adjacent cells, the connective cells like the glial cells, also the branches or the dendrites which form the connections between two adjacent neurons, they together form something called the neuropil. Okay, the neuropil will form or help in the density that helps make up the substance or the parenchyma of the cortex. Now, this aspect or this neuropil is the one that constantly undergoes change from childhood till your adolescence. And that's the one that's constantly getting trimmed and pruned and, you know, so that you have more and more efficient facilitation of transmission, neuronal transmission. So the graph here basically shows that sometimes an individual may not have very efficient pruning. And in those cases is when they touch something called psychotogenetic thresholds. That is, each of them fall under the risk category of having psychotic symptoms, and hallucinations are much more predominant in individuals having poor cortical pruning, so or unregulated cortical pruning. So that's one example. And again, this slide again suggests to us that these kind of these kind of models have been recreated in a lab condition, and again suggest the same thing. So individuals who have pruning of connections in the memory, working memory, often tend to have more hallucinations, and it's related to glutamatergic pathway deficiency. It's related to glutamatergic pathway dysregulation, related to GABAergic pathway deficiency, and so on. So these are the things that happen, and with poor levels of pruning or exaggerated levels of pruning, there are certain areas of the brain which function much more than they need to, and these are referred to as the parasitic foci. So these parasitic foci start to become areas of, you know, source of thought, and then they start having their impact on working memory, then they have an impact on their on speech perception, and so on. And they can thereby lead to different forms of manifestations of individuals having psychotic symptoms, more so hallucinations. So with this, I come to the end of the science of hallucinations. Of course, there's a way lot more that I would have ideally liked to speak of. There is another part of my slide, a presentation which includes the various different types of hallucinations and the conditions in which it's seen. But I do understand that this is a limited session. So if time permits, the next time that we meet, probably we can have a further discussion on that, and probably also touch upon therapies, which are quite new to the field of psychiatry itself. For example, the avatar therapy, and how those kind of interventions have a good future. Of course, needs a whole lot of research-based evidence. But of course, there is room for a lot more of interventions if we were to understand and try to make sense of whatever we've gone through in today's session. So Shweta, I just wanted to ask you if we can end with that for today.
Okay.
Or any of your other thoughts, however you would like.
Yeah, ma'am. We can end, and definitely we can have another session, part two of this.
Sure.
Yeah, and to actually conclude with, thank you so much, ma'am. And as I said in the intro, an amazing topic by an amazing mentor. Definitely, ma'am. The time flew like this, ma'am. It was actually really superb, and each and every slide caught our attention, and it was very interesting, ma'am. Thank you so much for sharing your knowledge, and we are ever grateful to you, ma'am. And definitely we will have another session of continuation of this, ma'am. And yeah, thank you so much, ma'am.